Good evening, dear friends. Hi, all. Welcome to another session with me, Varun Rao, on Ekagra. And in today's session, we would be looking at the martial dances of India. In the last couple of sessions, we have already covered classical dances and we've covered some folk dances, but then martial dances has not been covered. So in this video, it has covered martial dances. And martial dances can be a topic for your UPSC, APPSC, TSPSC, or any other exam. Any other state PCS, because this is something to do with your country, and any group one or group two or any senior kind of an examination would have this, a gazetted kind of an officer examination, right? So all the best for all you people who are preparing and who are about to give an attempt out there. And if you have liked the video and if you are looking forward to follow, you can follow me on Facebook and Instagram on varunrao_gemini@yahoo.com. or Varun Rao _ Gemini. And I, as you all know, I'm a developer and also a fellow aspirant just like you. And I believe that, education is everyone's birthright and it should not be snatched away just because of some privileges, or it should, not be, it should not be a leftover opportunity for someone because of some problem, like any problem. It could be financial or anything. So, I have taken this platform assuming that you all would allow me to help you in your preparation. I also have another channel, which is Tech Tablet, in which I post a lot of technical jobs, queries related to technical jobs. And in this channel, I'm just trying to post, the same material, the same content, which is available on website and other channels. But then I'm just trying to make it a bit easier for all of us to understand. Right now, talking about martial dances. So guys, martial dances is basically a very, very old part of Indian culture, right? It is as old as ancient Indian culture, right? Even when you did not have modern warfare or anything which is modern, we had martial dances and we had some martial art forms since then. And one of the most important forms of, martial display is kushti. Kushti is basically Indian wrestling. We find mention of kushti in a lot of epics like Ramayana, Mahabharata, etc. And in kushti, you have something like Mallayudh. Mallayudh is a variant of wrestling, right? All those who must have read or who must have heard about Krishna's story must have heard about the Bhima Jarasandh war in Mahabharata. It lasted for 27 days. It was a wrestling match between both of them. Okay. And then you also had another Dvandyudh between Parashuram and Bhishma, which lasted for 30 days. Bhishma is basically the most respected person of the Kuru dynasty. Okay. Bhishma is the son of Shantanu. And he's almost considered the head of the Kuru clan. He's considered the icon, the role model of Kuru clan. Okay, Bhishma Pitama. And then you have Manusmriti, which also talks about the rules of different, forms of martial dances or, war rules. Like if, while fighting, the top knot of, the top knot is the pony. If the pony of a warrior gets opened, then he should be given time to, tie the knot. If rules of this level are specified, then it definitely must be it must be understood that the rules were very much, understood and the game was very much respected, right? And from origin of these games or from origin of these variant of sports, we see the rise of martial dances. So in this video, I've just listed, I tried to list some martial dances with their photos so that you might be able to understand and visualize what these dances are basically about. Okay. So the first one we have is Pari-khanda. And Pari-khanda is basically a style of sword and shield, as you're able to see in the photo. He has a sword in his hand and in the other hand, he has a shield. And this art is basically from Bihar. It's a Rajput variant of art. Okay, and Rajput is basically a Kshatriya clan of, Kshatriya tribe, or it's not a tribe, it's a Kshatriya clan of many states. Okay, and the steps the techniques that we see in Pari-khanda are also used in Chow dance, and Chow dance is also seen in this place. Then you have Mardani Khel. Mardani Khel is from Maharashtra. And in this, this is also basically a warfare kind of a dance. I mean, all the martial dances, that is a thing which is very common. And this is basically from Maharashtra in Kolhapur. right? And we see that the Marathas gave a lot of influence, or they enjoyed Mardani Khel, and they in fact encouraged, and they encouraged women to, you know, learn all these martial dances. Then you have Lathi. Lathi is basically the world's oldest variant of martial art in India. Lathi is basically a stick. It's just pure Hindi. Okay, and this is practiced in Punjab and Bengal regions of India. And it still remains a very popular sport in many smaller villages of many states of the country. Then you have Thang Ta. Thang Ta is a very popular name, guys. It's in Manipur. It is completely weapon-based, all right? And in Thang Ta, Thang means sword, while Ta means a spear. You have a spear and a sword that are used, Thang Ta. Okay? And both of them, anything can be used. There are basically three variants of Thang Ta. Okay? The first is, ritual of nature. The second is the absolute spectacular performance. And the third one, as usual, should be a fighting technique. All these combined together would make or would form the essence of Thang Ta. Then you have Kathi and Karra Samu. Kathi Samu and Karra Samu basically are from Andhra Pradesh. Kathi means a sword and Karra means a stick, right? And here, as you're able to see in the photo, the contestant or the person would have arms in both his hands. Okay, either it would be a stick or either it would be a knife, but then he would be equipped with both his hands and the fight would go on between both the contestants. Then you have Musti Yuddha. Now this Musti Yuddha that we are talking about, it's called as the art of eight limbs. Okay, and this is very popular in UP, basically in Varanasi of UP. And this is popular right from Krishna times, though the name has changed and the sport has evolved, but this sport is basically very old and very famous. It's a very rarely visible, you know, thing right now, but it was very popular in Middle Age. And in this, there are basically no or zero weapons that are used, not even a stick. It's completely hands, and you just try to, you know, punch the enemy with your elbow, knees, and your wrist. That's it. That's all what you do. No arms of any sort are allowed. And this is complete art of physical, mental, and spiritual development. I mean, why is it mental and spiritual? When you go to a war or when you go to a fight, it is not just the matter of strength. It is also, you know, many other things come into picture when you're talking about a fight between two people, that too at a very high level, when you're talking of, you know, two people at a competitive level. We're not talking of roadside fights or, you know, some unorganized fights. We are talking of some staged, performanced fights which have some value to it, right? Which are organized by people, which are done in competitive spirit, which are not to injure or hurt others. Now, these kind of, you know, sports or these kind of things, they have certain rules and they have to abide by these rules. And as long as any contestant is not following these rules, the players are eliminated or disqualified. And until unless you have a complete all-round development of discipline, physical, mental, and spiritual understanding of yourself, you would not be able to make a name for yourself in sports like these. Okay, right. Then you have Silambam. Silambam is from Tamil Nadu. And, you know, this is a very famous South Indian variant of martial dance. Okay, and in this, what you have is a wide variety of weapons that are used. And some of these, you know, which are found anywhere in the world, like a stick, any weapon, anything can be made as a weapon. And there is also something called as Kuttu Varisai. It is, you know, the unarmed kind of martial art. In this, there are not even a stick is there. So, you know, Kuttu Varisai, when you say Kuttu Varisai, this is still a part of Silambam, but then there are no weapons. All right. And here you have a lot of art movements like snake, tiger, eagle. All these patterns are imitated. All right. Then you have Lakna Fnaba of Manipur. This is unarmed and a wrestling type. Okay, this is completely unarmed. You don't have any weapons in this. Now, all these three dances of this slide, or all these three art forms of these of this slide, they all are from Manipur. You have Mukna. Mukna is basically an armed and wrestling type. Again, here two men hold each other's hands, or you know, they have a cloth around, and you know, they just try to hold each other and they force another down, and the person who's on the top is considered the winner. He is declared to be the winner. Then you have sarit-sarak of Manipur. This is again an unarmed type. In this, this is basically, this variant is used for is for women to protect themselves. It's a very good defensive mechanism, or you know, when someone is trying to attack you. In this, you know, you just try to choke, or you know, you just try to stop the offensive action that's being done onto you. All right, so that is sarit-sarak. Then you have Kalarippayattu. Kalarippayattu is one of the oldest martial art from Kerala. Okay, and it is still in existence, and it is very famous. It's very famous. Okay, now when you say Kalari basically is a school, or you know, it's a training institute. It's a place where students go and get trained in different art forms. Okay, and it includes strikes, kicks, and also some weapon-based, you know, martial arts which are taught to them. And also footwork is one of the most important key in Kalarippayattu, right? And it's also considered to be one of the most used and the most attractive, and also the most, you know, famous variant of Indian martial art. And this is also used in many movies like Ashoka, The Myth, and etc. And Kalarippayattu is from Kerala. Okay, so all these you know, art forms that we are seeing, these are all you know, different art forms taking their origin at different place. Okay, so we have Pari-khanda from Bihar, Mardani Khel from Maharashtra, Lathi is from Punjab, okay, and Bengal as well. Thang Ta is from Manipur. Kathi Samu and Karra Samu from AP, Musti yuddha from UP, Silambam from Tamil Nadu, Lakhna Fanaba, Mukna, and sarit-sarak from Manipur, Kalarippayattu from Kerala. Now we have Thoda and Kuttu Varisai. Kuttu Varisai, as we just saw, it is, you know, a part of Silambam. As we saw, it is an unarmed kind of mixed, you know, martial art. When I say mixed martial art, please don't compare this to the MMA. It means stick, and you know, even weapons and you know, unarmed variants are used. Then you have Thoda. Thoda is again weapon based. It is available right from the times of Mahabharata, and it's completely to do with archery. Okay, it is a round piece of wood fixed to an arrow. So basically, it's archery. That's it. Kuttu Varisai, it's completely, you know, unarmed variant. In this, again, you follow patterns of tiger, snake, elephant, okay, and you do a breathing. Comprises a very important part of Kuttu Varisai. I mean, the ability to control your breath and the ability to release your breath when you're punching, so that you're conserving your energy in the right way. All this is a part of Kuttu Varisai, and this is also from Tamil Nadu basically, but then you can say it's from South India at large. Then you have Gatka. Gatka is from Punjab, and it is mainly used by Sikh. Okay, and Gatka is, you know, what does Gatka mean? It means, you know, one whose freedom belongs to race. It's basically what they deserve. They should get what they deserve. And what all do they use? They use a stick, a sword, a kirpan, or katar as a weapon. Okay, so katar is basically, you know, a sword or a stick. Okay, it's in Punjabi, it's in their language. Okay, and then you have Malyudh of South India. Malyudh is basically wrestling, just as you're able to see in this picture. And Malayudh is very ancient. It is, as we have discussed right in the beginning, Malayudh has its mentions even in the epics like Ramayana and Mahabharata. There are four variants of Malayudh. Okay, they are Hanumati, Jambuvanti, Jarasandhi, and Bhimaseni. Now we'll just talk about these variants. So Hanumati, as you all know, it is for technical superiority. Right, Jambuvati or Jambuvanti, as we all know, Jambuvan is a Mahabharata character. Jambuvan is very famous for locking and holding, like as you're able to see in the pic backward, you know, Balram. Okay, then you have Jarasandhi. Jarasandh is also an evil character who was killed by Bhim. Okay, now Jarasandhi is basically breaking off your hands and legs. And then you have Bhimaseni, which is sheer strength. Bhima, as we all know, one of the five Pandavas. Okay, he is a person who resembles sheer strength. So these are the four variants of Mallayudh that we have in our country. Okay, so these are all the different martial arts martial art forms that we have in our country. And most of them are taken in a brotherly way and they are celebrated in the country rather than using them as a cause for violence or a fight. All right. So the actual essence behind these sport is lost the day when we use them for the purpose of destruction of another person. So I hope you all have understood the meaning and the essence of martial arts in India. And I really hope you enjoyed watching this session and this presentation. Thanks a lot for watching and being there with me. In the next session, we will talk about some more things related to competitive examinations. And if in case you have liked the video, hit the like button. And for regular updates, you can hit the subscribe and bell icon. And for any queries, you can always use the comment section below. And if you feel that it might help at least another, do share this video for sure. Have a great day ahead and all the very best for the exam that you're about to take up.